emancipated convict and his family, I stopped for the night at his house. He was dwelling with much emphasis on the dangers of town life. He had a son too fond of getting into trouble. The son smiled at the father's fears, and then for the first time in his life, he went into his own sad history. He was surrounded by a fine family, two daughters, young, innocent, and beautiful, listened with pale countenance as he told his tale of crime, how he too had smiled at his own father's fears, how step by step he fell until he was branded with convictism. The girls slowly crept to their father's side and threw their arms around him. His wife, with tears streaming down her cheek, sat mutely by his side and kissed his hand. Infant children, struck with awe at what they could not understand, held up their little hands and with pouting lips said, "Me kiss dada too." The son, sullen and sorrowful, stood afar off, an old servant who had been a prisoner with clasped hands, watched the son's countenance. His limbs moved as though he was entreating one above in behalf of the heart-stricken father. There was a sad scene, and as the father held out his hand to his stubborn son, he, in a few brief and touching words, addressed his family. At least there was a yielding and approaching on the part of the son. He knelt for the parental forgiveness, humbled, subdued, and conquered. At bedtime, the voice of prayer and praise sounded in the dwelling, and the following morning, the father gave me a statement of his circumstances. He had two sons of marriageable age. There was something particularly touching and pathetic in this family scene. Hard-born experience carried with it an irresistible weight with it. The remembrance of all the trials and all the sorrows he had undergone seemed then to throw a saddened solemnity mixed with anguish into the features of the father. It was so blended with humility. Virtue appeared to struggle so with proud nature, until strong religious sentiments and parental affection made every other feeling